See, if I look here at the notes, it says morning, which was the topic of graduate work, three parts.
But I guess that's your notes and not mine. Well, today, we're here for Lisa's first seminar on her thesis work. Lisa joined our program about 2 years and 1 month ago. I first met Lisa when she was watering on a Saturday in the middle of a horticulture line. And I thought that was kind of dangerous. She was just out there kind of watering. Of course, we have vagrants that come up through the egg cabins from time to time. So I went over there and told her, you know, pay attention. She was just concentrating on the watering. And from then, I found out she was a forestry student, and eventually found out a little bit more about her, but it stays with friends. We decided to ask her to join our group, and we've vetted that one bit. Lisa is going to talk about her studies, and I say studies because she had really three separate studies for her master's work.
Well, you stole my opening line. Good morning. Here's the slide.
Oh, I'll shut the light on.
Today I'm going to be talking about seed management in Tennessee. This has been the topic of my graduate work for the past 2 years, and it consists of three parts with their own objectives. The first objective was to develop guidelines for the movement of tree seed in the absence of genetic testing. The second was to evaluate the distribution of acorns within the canopy of Northern Red Oak. And the third and final objective is to evaluate the effects of insecticide spray on acorn quality. First, I'll be talking about a cooperative effort to develop seed zones for the state of Tennessee. Genetic testing is the foundation for seed movement, and there is a lack of testing in hardwood species, and we don't have any guidelines for seed collection location. This causes state nurseries to have to get seed from anywhere and plant the seedlings in environments that are very different from the original location of the seed. So the objective of this study was to create a map of seed zones for resource managers to collect seed to reforest areas that with locally adapted genotypes. A seed zone can be defined by a homogeneous environment or environments mapped across a region to indicate geographic variation. The Tennessee Seed Zone map was developed using four data layers. And the first I'll talk about is elevation. This is a digital elevation model of Tennessee, and we defined zones according to the area of land, and the lower colors represent the lower elevations, the light colors, excuse me, represent lower elevations, and moving on up to the higher elevations. The second layer was temperature, and this data came from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. There was 30 years of data for the state of Tennessee on a county basis. And temperature was in the form of monthly mean and maximum and minimum temperatures. The precipitation layer came from data from the same source as the temperature and was in the form of monthly total precipitation. The different colors are the weather was the data was clustered, and that's why they're the same color. layer are Bailey's ecoregions. This is a classification system that reflects soil, landform, vegetation, fauna, and climate. And there are 9 regions in the state of Tennessee, from the Mississippi alluvial section to the Blue Ridge Mountains. Now, the method of analysis, we used centroid hierarchical cluster analysis for the weather data. And this just produced standardized values to represent a county's weather history. Using ArcInfo software, we combined each data layer into a single GIS coverage for Tennessee. There were 3 analyses. Each reduced the number of layers, or the number of zones in each layer each time. In the first analysis, we had over 300 seed zones. This was going to be way too many for resource managers on a practical level. It had 10 precipitation zones, 7 temperature zones, 5 elevation zones, and 9 ecoregions. So we reduced the number of zones in each layer, and then we superimposed Bailey's ecoregions rather than treating it as a layer. This was still too many. So the third analysis, we combined the temperature and precipitation data into one layer. We had our elevation layer with 4 zones. We superimposed those on Bailey's ecoregions. Here's the final product. And here in West Tennessee, there's a line going through Shelby County. I'll use this as an example. That's an ecoregion boundary. And on the left is red, and on the right is red, but those are different because they're divided by the ecoregion boundary. However, in the lack of seed source or location for planting, we propose that you may use seed from one ecoregion and take it to a neighboring ecoregion as long as the zone is the same color. This will be implemented on a county basis where roads have been overlaid. We've developed a system to easily identify the species and tree location, which has been accepted for use by the Tennessee Division of Forestry and the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agencies. The following 2 parts of my thesis were conducted at the Watauga Northern Red Oak Seedling Seed Orchard. It is located in Northeast Tennessee and began as a TVA progeny test in the early 70s. It was later turned over to Forest Service Management and thinned and is now a seed orchard. It's currently being used for field research, seed orchard management research, and we also use the acorns for regional reforestation, nursery trials, and also field studies. Part 2 of my thesis was also a cooperative effort with the USDA Forest Service to investigate the influence of competition on flowering and acorn maturation in northern red oak. Objective 1 was to investigate distribution patterns of flowers and acornets. The second objective was to evaluate the effect of intertree competition on these distributions. Acorn production varies on all levels, from the individual to the family to the population, and even over time. There are many causes to this, such as genetics, insects, and weather patterns. This causes resource managers to have a hard time orchard, and we selected 22 trees based on spacing requirements and acornet numbers. After we selected the trees, they were grouped according to competition level. We had open-grown trees, which had no competition. We had groups of trees with competition in one direction, such as the west, west 2, and east. We had a three-tree group, which had multi-direction competition. And then moving to all trees, which had varying levels of competition in any direction. Here's an example of an open-grown tree in the orchard. Here is a pear with having competition only in one direction. Moving to a more forest-like condition with competition in any direction. The data were collected using a Forest Service bucket truck, which sometimes got stuck, which makes data collection hard at times. And we tagged, branches were selected and tagged in each quadrant of the crown, in the upper and lower sections of the crown. They were tagged so we could go back every 3 weeks and count the flowers and acornets on each branch until the acorns were mature. Here in this picture, I don't know if you can see, that's an acorn weevil. Now we did this every 3 weeks for 2 seasons for a total of 12 inventories. Now I'm going to talk about statistical analyses, and we did chi-square tests to detect significant differences in flower and acornet distributions across the quadrants, among trees, or groupings of trees. Chi-square tests were also used to detect significant differences in distributions across quadrants in the upper, lower, and combined sections of the crown. Chi-square tests were also used to detect differences in these distributions across the quadrants between trees with competition and trees without competition. Again, chi-square tests were used to test the differences for each inventory date. The results we found for each grouping are as follows. For the single tree group, there was not really a distribution trend in the upper section of the crown. However, when we looked at the lower section of the crown, there was the majority of the flowers and acornets were located in the south quadrant. And also, when we combined these crowns, the upper and lower, we found again the south tendency. But when we looked at the groups with competition, there really wasn't a discernible trend to be found. They really occurred not equally in the quadrants, but just not necessarily in one quadrant. And this was more evident in the any direction where trees had competition on all levels. However, in these three competition groups, we did find that the majority of the acorns were in the upper section of the crown rather than the lower. Now, when we compared the groups with competition to the groups without competition, we found that their distributions were significantly different from one another. With the exception of the multi-direction group in the upper crown, which was not significantly different from the single trees. So, what we can conclude from this is that the single trees did exhibit the majority of their flowers and acornets in the south quadrant and combined, again, we saw the south quadrant pattern. Now, this could be due to more photosynthetic input on the south side. Another conclusion from objective one, that groups with competition exhibited random flower and acornet distribution patterns across the quadrants, and the competition did not result in a production in one quadrant as seen in the single trees. Now, this could be due to many factors, less resources or light, maybe genetics or environment. And conclusions from objective two, the effects of competition, are that multi-direction competition groups exhibited patterns similar to the single trees in the upper section. Now, this could be that three trees in a group act as a single tree, possibly. Other competition groups did not have similar patterns. Those groups were the one direction and then any direction. The final conclusion from objective two was that flower and acornet distribution patterns for trees without competition were different than patterns for trees with competition. Now, this might be said that competition did have an effect on distribution patterns. Now, the final part of my thesis was also a cooperative effort with the USDA Forest Service to evaluate the effect of insecticide spraying on acorn quality. Northern red oak acorn numbers are often heavily impacted by acorn predation during the two-year maturation process by both abiotic and biotic factors. Biotic factors such as tree hoppers or weevils, and abiotic factors are things such as weather and genetics. The acorn weevil is thought to have a major impact in the final stages of maturation of the acorn. So this study targeted it began at the time of emergence of these insects when they begin to start laying their eggs inside the acorns. And the objectives were to evaluate the effects of spraying, the types of damage to acorns from the two sides. Another objective was to evaluate the severity of damage to these acorns from each treatment. Then a final objective was to evaluate the overall effectiveness of the spray for damage control. Again, the experimental material for this study came from the orchard, where we selected two trees that could be easily divided by a barrier. Shown here in this picture is the barrier that stretched across the crown to posts on either side of the tree. And the bucket truck was again used for this, to get this accomplishment. It was pretty fun. Capture was chosen. Now that's an insecticide, and it was chosen because previous studies using Asana had resulted in scale outbreaks in the orchard. Oh, I'm sorry. That's the capture was sprayed at a rate of 7.9 milliliters for every 2.5 gallons of water. It was sprayed every 3 weeks to one side of the crown of each tree. The acorns were collected at the end of the season by hanging nets from the tarps and then labeling them A and B to keep them separate by treatment. The acorns were then dissected using shears, and they were cut in half lengthwise, and the damage was reported. And it was reported in the form of percent damage. So this acorn would be 75% damaged, 25% healthy. And that's how we got our severity values. The damage classifications are as follows. Weevil, which is seen at the top of your screen, that's the larvae, and they do all this damage. Filbert worm. Pith gall, this is the damage it causes to the outside of the acorn. Stone gall, there's the larvae. This is a wasp. And midge, it's an unidentified genus. It's really just a fly larvae. Also, we looked at disease, which was classified as a brown discoloration. And fungus was identified by white mycelium. And then air pockets, as indicated by the spaces between the cotyledon and the pericarp of the acorn. Now we get to statistical analyses again. We looked at control versus spray for floating and sinking acorns. And floating acorn is considered non-viable, and a sinking acorn is considered viable in a water test where you immerge them in water. We also looked at differences in specific and combined damage types, and also the degree of damage to cotyledons. The results from this study were very evident. We had significant differences found between treatments for both floaters and sinkers for one tree, but not the other. Now this graph shows the combined trees, and these were significant. There are more floaters on the control side and more sinkers on the spray side. Significant differences were also found for the weevil damage category only. And this was found for both floaters and sinkers for one tree, but only floaters for the other tree. Again, they were found, significant differences were found for the combined trees. And this graph shows just more acorns on the control side that were damaged by weevils. However, all other damage classifications were not significant for individual trees or combined trees. And we also had a variable that combined all damage types except weevils, because we're getting a strong weevil damage result, and we wanted to see if all the damage combined was significant, and it was not. Significant differences were found again between treatments for all damage combined, that is including weevils, for floaters and sinkers combined. And this is for each tree. We had more damage on the control side than on the spray. Again, here is the degree of weevil damage, where we did find significant differences between the treatments of individual trees and combined trees. this was for degree of legal damage and combined damage only. No other classification was significant. And again, you see more damage on the control side. I'm going to need my other parents' help, please, for the confusion. The conclusions from objective one were that weevils were the primary damaging agent to the acorns, and the effects of other damage types were negligible. Conclusions from objective two were that weevil damage was more severe on the control sides of each tree and for the combined trees. And weevil damage was more severe to the floaters than to the sinkers. But this makes sense because as damage increases and an acorn loses its healthy endosperm, its chance of becoming a floater in the float test increases. So we had probably had more, you know, obvious damage to the floaters. The third and final objective that the spray was effective in reducing damage to acorns, and the capture actually worked. In the future, when evaluating the effectiveness of different insecticides, an analysis to detect quantitative differences between treatments should be conducted rather than an analysis based on qualitative differences. Now, between treatments, you're looking at numbers or severity. One treatment's better than another based on the severity of damage. Whereas floating and sinking acorn categories are qualitative, just based on a name you give these acorns based on the float test. For practical use, however, differences must also be found between the percentages in sinking acorns because those are the only ones that are going to be planted. So, the study I just talked about was conducted 2 summers ago where we just divided in the tree in two. And the following summer, we did another study where we had 6 trees and we divided them into 3 parts using 2 different insecticides and again a control. And that's what that looks like. The acorns have been dissected, but the data has not been analyzed at this point. Here's another shot. Those are phenomenal in the field. You would be amazed. At the scale of those. So, I just want to conclude with one final slide. I did a lot of chi-square tests. I think I did more than 3,000, but that was the mathematical final. And those are including do-overs, so. I know a lot about chi-square, if anybody wants to ask me anything about that, but any more questions, I might be able to answer them, but thank you.
Lisa's going to have her final examination after. Any questions from our people that are not on her committee?
I have a question.
Sure.
Did you find in total numbers of acorns any differences in the open grown trees and the ones with competition? In other words, did the open grown trees have more acorns?
We didn't really look at actual production numbers, but I can tell you just from being in the trees that yes, because it did have a lower crown crop, I would say
results for the quadrants of the trees seem to indicate that there's a real effect of light there and how many acorns that produce. Do you think that soil moisture competition could also be affecting, say, the number of acorns per tree in those competition trials or in those situations?
Yes, I think it's probably a lot of factors, light and
all
soil.
Different.
Oh, yeah.
I was wondering what the information is on that.
The
I'm interested, yeah, I wonder in literature
really
and that sort of thing.
Yeah, there's really
not. Because I have an interest
not.
In that, too, of increasing production in the field for any tree mass.
From this study, the only obvious variable was light, and I can say, probably thinning or just increasing the available light to the top of the
ground. Yeah, that's a clear thing.
But the literature, again, is very large.
That's not, I'm looking for that literature right now.
More questions? Sure, it made all sense to you. Russ?
Yeah, if there's any effort underway to release these pesticides for general orchard management use?
I know that forestry is actually trying for them, and I mean, these were available for research purposes only, but I think that capture and Durzban, which we used in the second study, I don't think those are available for just public use. I know Durzban is available for cotton, but that's it. I think they are trying, to get it. There's an effort.
Any other questions? Okay, we'll take